Hey, I am excited to be here, and I'm excited about all that is going on this weekend. Incredible things are happening, and I'm just glad to get to be a part of this and worshiping with you all. Years ago, Queen Victoria, who is the Queen of England, had a real interest in yacht racing at that particular time in her life. And there was one important day where there was going to be this big cup race that was held out in the English Channel. And the American yacht was favored to win the race, but the English yacht was also considered to be a contender. And she was such an avid yachting fan that Queen Victoria had them construct this small lean-to out on the cliffs of Dover. And she even went to the trouble of not just having some seats for some other dignitaries there with her, but she also stationed a man with a telescope out there on the cliffs so that he would be able to see which yacht was coming in first when they came around the bend. And so they all sat there, and Queen Victoria was there with her vast entourage, and they were excitedly and patiently waiting. And finally, after some time, the man with the telescope hollered back and said, "Your Majesty, there's a sail in sight." And she said, "Well, look and tell me, is it the English yacht or is it the American yacht?" And he looked back and he said, "Madam, it is the American yacht." And she was a little disappointed, but she said, "Look and tell me which sail is in second. Tell me which sail is in second." And the man looked and he looked and he looked for a long time. And finally he looked back and he shook his head and he said, "Madam, there is no second sail." In other words, the American yacht was so far out in front that he couldn't even see who was in second place. That's how it is with Jesus Christ. You can take all of your great leaders. You can take all your great sports figures. You can take all your great business leaders. You can take all your great educators. You can take all of your Nobel Prize winners, and you can stack them up, and together, they don't even come in second. Jesus is so far out in front, you can't even see a second sail. Last week, we discovered that Jesus was different than any man who has ever lived. And this week, we want to wrap up this two-week series by just saying that Jesus' life of love changed the course of history forever. And we're going to look at his life of love, and we're going to try to see what exactly that looked like and how it is that we can kind of follow in his steps. You know, there's a passage in John chapter 13, and you're familiar with it. You probably have it committed to memory. But Jesus is talking, and he says in John chapter 13, verse 34, he says, "A new commandment I give to you, that you love one another. Just as I have loved you, you also are to love one another. By this, all people will know that you are my disciples, if you have a love for one another." So Jesus is saying love is to be the hallmark characteristic. Love should be the standout distinctive that reveals to others that you are a Christ follower. So the question becomes, how can we love like Jesus did? And we begin with the backdrop where Jesus contrasts the way society normally interacts with people and how he encourages his followers to be different and not to follow the crowd. We talked about that a little bit last week. Now here's the first way, if you want to fill this in on your outline, and that is to love those who disagree with you. Love those who disagree with you. There will be people who disagree with you. And there were people who disagreed with Jesus in very big ways, and yet Jesus continued to love them. He is always pointing out ways that his followers could be significantly different than the rest of the culture. And throughout the Sermon on the Mount, we see all sorts of different marching instructions. And he even talks about those who disagree with you, how it is that you are to interact with them. In Matthew chapter 5, we pick the Sermon on the Mount up with verse 43. Jesus says, "You have heard that it was said, 'You shall love your neighbor and hate your enemy.' But I say to you, love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you, so that you may be sons of your Father who is in heaven. For he makes his sun rise on the evil and on the good, and he sends rain on the just and on the unjust. For if you love those who love you, what reward do you have? Do not even the tax collectors do the same? And if you greet only your brothers, what more are you doing than others? Do not even the Gentiles do the same?" Here's what Jesus is saying. He's saying, even the unrighteous, Even the unrighteous, even those who are far away from God, are in the habit of loving those who love them. That's very basic, right? Even a pagan would do that, Jesus says. But being a Christ follower is anything but basic. It's about being distinctive. It's built on a foundation of love, a love that expresses that everyone has value, that everyone can be used by God, that everyone matters, even those people who might disagree with you. You all know the name Dwight Moody, especially here in Chicagoland. You know the name Dwight Moody. He was a preacher in the 1800s, and he was the founder of the Moody Bible Institute here. And he was often criticized from within the Christian community. And one time he received an anonymous letter that had just one word written on it. It simply said in large capital letters, "Fool," and that was it. And Moody joked that it was the only time in all his life where he received a letter where the person forgot to write the message but remembered to sign their name. And whether you work at a church or whether you lead a small business, whether you work on an assembly line, there will always be people who will disagree with you. And nowadays we run into a lot of sharp conflicts with people. We are living in a world that is politically polarized. We are probably more divided as a nation right now than we have ever been. And we talk about loving others, but the reality is sometimes in our minds, we dilute this directive from the divine to mean, well, I think what God wants is he wants me to love those people who believe the same way that I do. Or he wants me to love those people who are nice to me. Or he wants me to love people if they love me first. But my hunch is that there is someone who opposes you. There is someone who unfairly criticizes you. There is someone, maybe it's a coworker, perhaps it's a relative or a neighbor, who sees this life through a very different set of eyes than you do. And yet your job is to love them with the love of Christ. Here's the second way that Jesus loved people. Love those who are disadvantaged. That's what Jesus did. Throughout the Gospels, we see Jesus interacting with so many people who had some struggle, some emotional or physical disadvantage or difficulty that life had dealt them. And he didn't do this in order to enhance his position in society. In fact, it no doubt probably raised eyebrows from many and ridicule from some. But Jesus Christ genuinely cared about others. And I want you to envision the lineup of people that would be there to see Jesus when he would start healing people in a town. Think about when you go to a doctor's office and you sit in the waiting room and you are surrounded in there by a whole bunch of sick people. And you're sick. And yet, even though you're sick, you still don't want to sit too close to the person beside you, right? Because you're thinking, I might get what he's got. And maybe she coughs and doesn't cover her mouth, and you're just trying to turn away and do anything you possibly can to salvage what little health you have in that moment, right? Well, multiply that by about 100. And that's how it was for Jesus Christ each and every day of his ministry. And the long line of people that were waiting to see him, these weren't sprained ankles. This wasn't a case of dandruff. It wasn't athlete's feet or a case of the sniffles. No, these people were struggling. And they were struggling with something that was significant. And this long line of people were right there, a different group in a different place each day, wanting his time, wanting healing from him. These were the people who were often overlooked, ostracized by society. But Jesus Christ genuinely cared about them. He was drawn to the disadvantaged. Is it any wonder he followed up a parable with these words in Matthew chapter 25, verses 41 through 45? Then he will say to those on his left, "Depart from me, you cursed, into the eternal fire prepared for the devil and his angels. For I was hungry, and you gave me no food. I was thirsty, and you gave me no drink. I was a stranger, and you did not welcome me, naked, and you did not clothe me, sick and in prison, and you did not visit me." And then they also will answer saying, well, Lord, when did we see you hungry or thirsty or a stranger or naked or sick or in prison and did not minister to you? And then he will answer them saying, truly I say to you, as you did not do it to one of the least of these, you did not do it to me. Those are haunting words to me. After that long list of all these people that it's so easy for us to overlook, Jesus says that was me. And if you walk right past them, if you don't give them the time of day, it's just like you just blew me off. That's what Jesus is saying. Anytime you serve, anytime you take the focus off of self and place it on others, you are humbling yourself. And at the core of Christianity, at the core of being a Christ follower, is that of servanthood. My Uncle Greg had cerebral palsy. He died several years ago. He was a quadriplegic. He was the greatest inspiration to me. I'm not supposed to have a favorite uncle, but he was my favorite uncle. He was able to get around quite well with an electric wheelchair, but his speech was quite difficult for people to understand. And sometimes we would spend 10 or 15 minutes just trying desperately to decipher one sentence. And several years ago, he attended a handy camp week. It was a week at camp for people with disabilities. And there was a guy that was assigned to him. His name was John Miller. And John had never volunteered to work with the disabled, and yet he signed up to work at this week at camp. And so that means for four straight days, he did everything with my Uncle Greg. And I mean, he did everything. He fed him every bite that he ate. He gave him every drink. He laid him in his bed at night. He took him to the bathroom and helped him out there for 4 days. My Uncle Greg had never gone swimming in his life, and of course he couldn't swim, but John got this apparatus that allowed Greg, as this flotation device, that allowed him to go in the lake there, and with four men all around him, they took my Uncle Greg into the water, and he swam for the first time in his life. And he had so much fun out there that they nicknamed my uncle the fish, because he had so much fun out there. Well, when it comes time for the last day, they have a closing ceremony. At the closing ceremony, at the end of it, what they do is the person who has been the helper, the volunteer assigned to that particular person, would get up front and they would kind of recap all week long all the different things that had taken place. And then they would always conclude by asking the question, what's your favorite thing about camp? And everybody always said one of two things. That was always the answer. It was either swimming or it was the snacks. Right? Sounds pretty normal to us, just like any week at camp. And sure enough, they had Uncle Greg come up in his wheelchair, and John walked through the whole week and all the different things that they had done and talked about him swimming out in the water. He worried a little bit about if people would be able to understand what his favorite part was, but he thought they'd be able to get swimming. And so he asked the fish, "Say, what was your favorite part of the whole week?" And everyone could understand because Greg raised his hand up and pointed his finger at John and said, "You." John said, "Well, it had to be something else." He said, "Was it the snack time or was it swimming?" And once again, Greg raised his shaky hand and he said, "You." Sometimes our acts of service seem meaningless and mundane at the time. And later we find out just how important they are. And even though John's life and my Uncle Greg's life were vastly different, a friendship had been formed. What created that friendship? Someone getting out of his comfort zone and loving the disadvantaged. And I can assure you that through John's humble service, my Uncle Greg caught a glimpse of Jesus Christ. Mark Twain said it like this. He said, "Kindness is the language the deaf can hear and the blind can read." You see, in God's kingdom, each of those people have worth. In God's economy, those who are physically disadvantaged are loved by God just as much as someone who seemingly has no physical or emotional challenges. And yet we all recognize that we all have issues. And Jesus talks a little bit more about this, and you talk about something that will get your attention the next time that you think about who you want to invite to come to something. Luke chapter 14, verses 12 through 14, Jesus says this. He says, when you give a luncheon or a dinner, do not invite your friends, your brothers or sisters, your relatives or your rich neighbors. If you do, they may invite you back, and so you will be repaid. But when you give a banquet, invite the poor, the crippled, the lame, the blind, and you will be blessed. Although they cannot repay you, you will be repaid at the resurrection of the righteous. I'm here to tell you that the gates of heaven and the streets of gold are handicap accessible. But the second you see Jesus Christ in heaven, you are changed instantly. You will have a glorified body. You will have a glorious body. You will be changed. There will be no infirmities. There will be no sickness. There will be no disease. There will be no paralysis. And so, why make those people wait? Why make them wait for heaven? Love them. Reach out to them. Value them every chance you can. Well, here's a third way that you can love like Jesus, and that is to love those who are different than you. Jesus did. You probably are aware by this point in the message that Jesus was no respecter of persons. He loved everyone equally. He served everyone equally. So Jesus loved the sick. Even though he was healthy, Jesus loved the sick. And think back in Jesus' day of leprosy that was rampant back then. When Jesus walked the earth in that first century, leprosy was a disease, this infectious disease that was so contagious. In fact, it still is today. In fact, we have it in the United States. You don't hear that much about it, but we have cases in the United States, and there's a place where they go in Louisiana if it is at a point that is farther along until their treatment can come alongside of them so that it's not contagious to other family members. But back in the first century, they didn't have a treatment then. And so if you got a spot of leprosy anywhere on your body, it was just a matter of time before your whole body would be covered with it. It's this contagious, infectious skin disease. And when discovered, you would have to move and leave your family, and you would go to a leper colony, and you would live out your life there. If there was an occasion where people had to leave the leper colony to travel to go somewhere else for some reason, they would all travel together in a band. They would just all walk together. Some theologians and commentators say that they had bells that they would wear around their neck, and they would shake those bells. But on top of that, they would scream at the top of their lungs, "Unclean, unclean." And if you were a mom and you were at the market and you heard somebody screaming out, "Unclean," and you heard those bells sounding, the first thing you did was you raced to your kids and you got them together and you made certain that you were on the other side of the street when the lepers went walking past. I don't know how to describe it except to say that if somehow we could understand it, the self-worth of those individuals had to be in the negative numbers. It just had to be. No one would touch them. No one would talk to them. No one would interact with them. They were apart from their family and close friends, and they were sequestered off with others who were just like them. There's this really cool story. There's a lot of cool stories with Jesus. We're going to spend some time this summer in a series that starts next week, just looking at different characters of the Bible. And the title of the series is Unsung, and we're going to look at some people who had an extraordinary faith and how God used them. And you'll see some of these people that are talked about in the Gospels in a few of them. And in Mark chapter 1, verse 40 and 41, everybody else is staying away from those with leprosy except for Jesus. Look at verse 40. It says, "A man with leprosy came to Jesus and begged him on his knees, 'If you are willing, you can make me clean.' And Jesus was indignant. He reached out his hand and he touched the man. 'I am willing,' he said. 'Be clean.'" Now, I want you to notice something. When they come on the scene, when this man afflicted with leprosy comes on the scene, Jesus doesn't run. Jesus stays right there. He doesn't call for his disciples and say, whoa, I need a buffer zone right here. It just got crazy. No, he doesn't do that. Instead, Jesus talks to the man, says, what is it that you want? How can I help you? How can I serve you? Jesus stays right there. And notice this, when Jesus heals this man, before he heals him, he does something. Did you notice it? Before he heals him, he does something. He touches him. The Bible tells us that he's not healed yet. If you look at the order, it's very matter of fact in how it's spoken. But he says, he reached out his hand and he touched the man. And then Jesus said, I am willing. I wonder how long it had been since that man had been touched by anyone. I wonder if the touch meant more than the healing. I wonder if the fact that Jesus was willing to get close to him. Maybe you need to touch someone in an appropriate way. A pat on the back, one of your kids. An arm about the shoulder to someone going through a rough time. Maybe it's a fist bump from a friend who there's been some tension in that relationship. Maybe it's your spouse who holds your hand in spite of the disagreement that you've had, or who touches you in an effort to rekindle the love that you once had. Jesus doesn't stop, though, with the touch. He heals the person. Everyone else was intimidated. Everyone else was scared of this man, not Jesus. He loved those who were different, even those who were sick. But he didn't stop there. He loved those who were poor. He spent time with the poor. He elevated the poor. He talked a great deal about the poor. In Luke chapter 21, there's this awesome story. The disciples are outside the temple treasury, and they're kind of observing what all is taking place. And in verse 1 of Luke chapter 21, verses 1 through 4, it says, Jesus looked up and saw the rich putting their gifts into the offering box, and he saw a poor widow put in two small copper coins. And I'm going to stop right there for just a second, because you have to understand, back in the temple treasury, they had this trumpet-shaped receptacle, and people would put their money and their gifts in there, and you would hear the sound of it as it would go down. Think of like if you go out to eat today and there's a place you can put a quarter in and get a gumball, and it goes spinning and it goes all the way around and everybody turns and they hear it as it's making its way down. That's how it was with the money. And so they would put their money in that. Now imagine a person giving $100, changing it in for quarters, and then they just pop it down, and all of a sudden you hear this sound for a long time. And so the larger the gift, the longer the sound went on, and people would look back and say, oh, wow, that's a generous gift. That's a generous gift. And so the disciples are nearby, and they just kind of start hearing these things. So let's pick it back up in Luke chapter 21. I'll start at the start because I don't want you to lose this. Jesus looked up and saw the rich putting their gifts into the offering box, and he saw a poor widow put in two small copper coins. And he said, truly I tell you, this poor widow has put in more than all of them. For they all contributed out of their abundance, but she, out of her poverty, put in all that she had to live on. I mean, think about it. She had two coins. She could have even kept one. She gave everything that she had, and Jesus knew it. Jesus noticed someone that no one else could. And it's not that the gifts of the rich or the middle class weren't valuable or needed in the temple. It's that the gift of the poor woman was also valuable, maybe even more so, because Jesus knew the backstory behind it. He knew the amount of sacrifice that it represented. It was all that she had. Jesus loved those who were different. They may have been sick. They may have been poor. They may have fallen into that category, though, that is one of the most overlooked in our society. You know what that is? It's the rich. Throughout the Gospels, we see Jesus reaching out to those who were rich, even though from a worldly perspective, he wasn't. The Bible says the Son of Man did not even have a place to lay his head. And yet he interacted and he built friendships with people who were wealthy. And we see it time and time again. Why would he do that? Well, it's very simple. Everyone mattered to Jesus. Whether they were sick, whether they were healthy, whether they were poor, whether they were rich. Are you ever guilty of looking at someone with affluence or someone with monetary wealth, and you think, oh, well, they'd never come visit church with me, or they'd never be open to a spiritual conversation. Do you just assume because they have everything they need physically that they must have everything that they need spiritually? I guarantee you, for many of them, there is a hole in their soul that only Jesus Christ can fill. And you have the boldness to invite them to experience hope and to see what Jesus does. Some of the wealthiest people I know are some of the loneliest people I know, because Jesus Christ isn't in the picture in their life. Now, that's not always the case, but it's more difficult for those who are wealthy to have friendships, because some people have a tendency to care more about what someone can do for them rather than if there really is chemistry there and camaraderie as friends. And that must be difficult, because there's a risk there, and there's also a risk for the one who reaches out to those with wealth, because while their motives may be pure, others may mistakenly question their intentions. Now, if you study through the Gospels, you'll be aware that Jesus had a number of affluent friends. There was Nicodemus, there was Matthew the tax collector, there was Lazarus, Joseph of Arimathea, Zacchaeus the tax collector. All of them would be considered the upper class, but here's the thing. He looked beyond their possessions. Jesus was always trying to find what it would be that would be an obstacle between that individual having a relationship with God. And Jesus' ministry was crystal clear. Whether you are rich, whether you are poor, the kingdom of God is for you. And since that's the case, there's no room for us to discriminate against those who are different from us for any reason. Jesus didn't. Here's what's significant. Either extreme was the same in his eyes, and he valued both equally. But we have a tendency to take shots at whatever is the opposite extreme in which we find ourselves. And so if we don't feel like we have much, then we take shots at those who we feel like have a whole lot. And if we have been blessed with a lot, then we have a tendency to look down at others, and we question why it is that they're poor. And all the while, Satan has a heyday trying to get those of wealth to mock those who are less fortunate and those who are poor to take shots at those who are rich. But in a culture and in a community, and especially in a church, we need people from all social strata fleshing out Christianity. We need every one of us from within our own sphere of influence to be a positive light on behalf of Jesus Christ and to make a difference for him. Because once you give your life and submit your plans to him, you discover that the ground is level at the foot of the cross. And Jesus wants us to be servants. Jesus wants us to get out of our comfort zone and reach out to those who are different, whether they are different physically or whether they are different financially. Well, there's one last group that I want us to look at, and that is love those who are in desperate circumstances. When I say the word desperate, for some reason my mind drifts back to my love life in high school. I don't really know how to explain that, but that's what I think of when I see desperate circumstances. That's a perfect description of me in high school. The depth of relationships back then could be measured by what the girl posted on the inside of her locker. Now they post on social media. Now you could tell on the inside of their locker, or the other way you could tell was what they put on the front of their notebook. Y'all remember that? First one, if they had somebody that they were really excited about, they wrote their name right there on the front, you know, Randy forever. Be right there on the front of the notebook. Billy and me for eternity. My girlfriend put Dave for the moment, you know. Just kind of how it went down. It wasn't much better for me in college. My freshman year, there was a big breakfast banquet on campus. I hadn't dated much, but my two roommates talked me into turning that breakfast banquet into a triple date with them. I said, I really don't want to go. They said, you ask a girl. I said, I don't know what to say. I don't know what to do. They said, Dave, you just follow our lead. You just do what we do. And so I let them, against my wishes, talk me into it. I said, okay, I'm going to watch you guys like a hawk. I'll try to do exactly what you do. I asked a girl. We triple dated. We went to the breakfast banquet. First guy looked across the table into the eyes of the girl that he loved. He said, pass the sugar, sweetie. We're talking romantic stuff here, all right? My other roommate looked across the table into the eyes of the girl that he loved that week. He said, "Pass the syrup, honey." Pressure was on Big Dave. I looked across the table and said, "Pass the tea, bag." It did not work out well, all right? At that time, I was in a desperate circumstance, all right? Now, unfortunately, Jesus wasn't around to console me, but Jesus, when he walked the earth, he loved people in desperate circumstances, whether it was some relational drought, whether it was a physical crisis, whether it was an emotional challenge. And so we have to ask ourselves, are we willing to get out of our comfort zone and stretch ourselves and reach out to those who are desperate? There is nothing like it when a person in desperation reaches out to God. The problem is most of us are never willing to allow ourselves to get to that point. Vance Havner said that the problem is the situation is desperate and we are not. And there's a whole world of people who don't realize just how desperately they need Jesus Christ in their life. And there's a risk involved when you reach out to them. In Mark chapter 5, there's this story of where Jesus reaches out to some people who are desperate. It's actually one person. They're on the other side of Galilee, and Jesus says, "Hey, let's go to the other side of the Sea of Galilee." And they're like, "Okay," the disciples say, "I wonder why he wants to go." But Jesus takes them over there, and when they get to this other side of the Sea of Galilee, it was truly the other side of the tracks, because where Jesus took them was an area known as the Gadarenes, or some call it the Gerasenes. And it was a mountainous area. There were cliffs all around there, and there was a reason people didn't go there. It was because there was very little there. It kind of opened the doorway to 10 other towns and cities called the Decapolis, but you could get there along the shoreline in another way. Why in the world would Jesus have us come to the area of the Gadarenes? And right in this area, it was known that there was a demon-possessed man who lived in some caves. You say, well, how would everyone know that? Well, the configuration of the Sea of Galilee, whenever he would come out of his cave and he would scream in torment, everyone who was out fishing, everyone who was on a boat heard it. Didn't matter where you were. People had tried to bind him, but he was too strong. They couldn't subdue him. They had chained him. He broke through the chains. He would cut himself with rocks all day long. He would just bleed. He would scream at the top of his lungs. He was naked. And that's where Jesus chooses to go. And he gets out of the boat and walks out of the boat, and here comes this wild man out of the caves running down to Jesus, and he's yelling at the top of his voice. And this demon-possessed man, who's naked and bleeding, says, "What do you want from me, Jesus, Son of the Most High God?" And Jesus says to him, come out of this man, you impure spirit. And the man yells at the top of his voice, "What do you want with me, Jesus, Son of the Most High God?" Look at verse 9 in Mark 5. Jesus asked him, "What is your name?" He replied, "My name is Legion, for we are many." And he begged him earnestly not to send them out of the country. And now a great herd of pigs was feeding there on the hillside, and they begged him, saying, "Send us to the pigs, let us enter them." So he gave them permission, and the unclean spirits came out and entered the pigs and the herd, numbering about 2,000, and they rushed down the steep bank into the sea, and they drowned in the sea. And the next paragraph tells us that this man sat down with Jesus and the disciples, and he was in his right mind, and he had a conversation with them. What changed? Well, he'd come in contact with Jesus Christ. He had an encounter with the Son of the living God. Notice that Jesus didn't run when he ran toward him. I would have run. If I saw a demon-possessed man running at me, I would have run, but not Jesus. Look at verse 18. As he was getting into the boat, it's talking about Jesus, the man who had been possessed with demons begged him that he might be with him, and he did not permit him, but said to him, "Go home to your friends and tell them how much the Lord has done for you and how he has had mercy on you." And he went away and began to proclaim in the Decapolis how much Jesus had done for him, and everyone marveled. So this man pleads with Jesus, I want to share your story with everybody. Let me go with you. I want to travel with you. That tells you something about the man. He was evangelistic. He wanted to share what had happened, his dramatic transformation. And Jesus says no, and he doesn't let him go with him. You see, Jesus was no ordinary preacher. Any other preacher would say, hey, you know what? This could really be good. That's going to look really good on the marquee. Jesus coming to Bethany and special guest, the Gadarene demoniac, PG-13. Hopefully he will be clothed. You know, I don't know what they put on the marquee, right? But that's what he could have done. He could have said, yeah, go with me, travel with me. I want everybody to hear this dynamic testimony. But Jesus doesn't let him come with him. You know why? He wants the man's family and friends and everyone in that region who had seen him that way for years to experience the transformation that's taken place. And so Jesus comes all the way across the water. He sees one person and heals him, and then he leaves. And the disciples have got to be thinking, what a waste of time. One measly healing. But you have to know the rest of the story. Jesus comes back to that area. And when he comes back and he arrives on the scene, that's the second large group feeding that he does. And this time, the people are so mesmerized by his teaching that there are 4,000 people who have come out from the Decapolis. And now Jesus teaches them. Why would 4,000 people come to hear Jesus in the same place where he had been before and only one person came? Because that one person had been transformed by Jesus, and he told everybody. And they said, if that man can change that dude, then maybe there's hope for me. Jesus specializes in changing people. Jesus is constantly reaching out to people. I wonder who you could reach out to. You see, Jesus was constantly reaching out to others. He had conversations with an ambitious lawyer, an adulterous woman, a doubting disciple, a money-hungry tax collector, a wealthy ruler, a poor single mom, a criminal on a cross, an unclean woman in a crowd, a paralyzed man, a foreign woman walking to get water. 1 John chapter 3, verse 18. I put it on your note page. Let's not merely say that we love each other. Let us show the truth by our actions. I don't know if you realize this, but the Gospels never record Jesus saying the words, I love you, to anyone. Now, don't misunderstand me. I'm not saying that Jesus never said those words, because I think he did. But I wonder if God, in his infinite wisdom, through his inspired word, chose not to record him saying that, to call attention to the fact that every conversation, every action, every deed, every healing communicated that he loved people. You see, it's impossible to look at a cross and see the perfect Son of God hanging from that cross, dying for our sins, and see his outstretched arms and not realize that Jesus is looking at us and saying, I love you. So let's show the world Jesus' love. Let's do it by loving those who are disadvantaged, those who are different than us, those who disagree with us, and those who are desperate. Because when we love, we show people a glimpse of Jesus. Let's pray. Father in heaven, in your word you tell us, you say, when did we see you hungry, or when did we see you thirsty, or in need, or sick, or in prison? And you reply, whatever you did for one of the least of these, you did it for me. And so, Lord, will you help us to open our eyes, to have eyes like Jesus, and will you help us to see people for who they can become through you rather than who they are right now? Will you help us to see ourselves that same way? May we see potential rather than problems. It's in the powerful name of the one who specializes in transformations that we pray. And all God's people said, amen.